and then we will take you in turn in that way, and also to keep the comments and the questions succinct and brief. The first talk of this session is on the application of scanning tunneling spectroscopy to catalyst research, platinum on silica. It is an offering from the Department of Chemistry at Yamanashi University in Tokyo, Japan. It will be given by Dr. Tomiyama.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have been working on this particular subject for some time now. Interest has been centered around the surface characterization of supported metal catalysts by SPM-SPS. And today, I would like to introduce our recent work on the observation of platinum silica monocatalyst system, which has been commonly believed not practical by SPM-SPS. In this slide, I made a short review of previous SPM-SPS works on supported metal catalysts. Despite all the favorable characteristics of SPM, such as high spatial resolution and the operability under ambient conditions, its application to supported metal catalyst study has been limited only to a handful, as you may see in this slide. Furthermore, the catalyst systems examined by SPM so far have also been limited, and in fact they are limited to the system of conductors and semiconductors. This apparently originates from the working principle of SPM, which requires samples electric conductivity. Supported metal catalysts, however, are commonly on non-conductive support, such as silica or alumina. And for those systems, one may use atomic force microscope, as few researchers have done, which utilizes atomic force rather than tunneling electrons, and thus requires samples no electric conductivity. However, precisely for that reason, atomic force microscope is not limited to the observation of subtopography, and no spectroscopic information is obtainable. Therefore, it seems that there is certain advantages if one can examine metals on non-conductive supports by SPM-SPS. So starting the present work. The strategy we took for the SPM-SPS observation of a non-conductive material is first to make it into a very thin film and then to identify its optimal observation conditions. The underlying idea of this strategy is that there exists no essential difference among conductors, semiconductors, and non-conductors. They are conveniently classified only by the size of the bandgap. Here we choose platinum silica as a model supported metal catalyst. For the silica support, we used thin silica film, spontaneously formed on bonds of silicon 100 surface. Its thickness is about 0.7 nanometer, as measured by SPS. Platinum particles were deposited on the silica surface by vacuum deposition. Let us first examine the SPM characteristics of the silica surface, and then this platinum silica model catalyst. Now, the first question that may come to your mind, would it be really possible to image the silica surface by SPM? In order to answer this question, we made a kind of spectroscopic measurement on this silica surface by monitoring the peak sample distance with a sweeping tunneling bias voltage, keeping the tunneling current constant. This slide shows one such measurement. Here, the peak sample distance is represented on the ordinate by the voltage applied to the D piezo, which is the voltage necessary to move it away from the sample. The example distance curve shown here is characterized by step responses when the bias voltage is switched from 0 to 5 volts. The positions of these steps vary from place to place on the sample curve. The lower steps here are commonly found somewhere in between 0.2 to 0.8 bias voltage. The higher step is found somewhere in between 2.5 to 3.5 bias voltages. So this actually modifies the preference dispersion. The curve shown here and the graph given in the preference is the one that shows the lower limit for these two steps. Now, such a step response can be interpreted to indicate the opening of a new electron channel at these particular bias voltages. Now, from this or these data, we can deduce the electronic structure in the silica silicon system. This is the electronic structure of the silica silicon system deduced from the precision spectroscopic measurements. Axis is a distance, silica out here, silica silicon interface here, silica tendon here, and the STM peak covering about the silica surface. Ordinate represents energy. Fermi is placed here, and if you apply bias voltages slightly above the Fermi, tunnel electrons do flow from the tip to the sample. Through some impurity and or defect levels. When you increase bias voltages to about 0.5 electron volt, then the electron can now tunnel into silicon conduction band, the extra electron, so the in order to keep the tunnel current constant, it moves away from the surface. If you increase the tunnel bias voltage to about 3 electron volt, tunnel electrons can now go into silica conduction band and it moves further away from the surface. So this is the trajectory of the tip that you saw just a moment ago. From these discussions, we conclude that if we apply bias voltages below about 3 volts, then you would be imaging silica silicon interface. Silica film being transparent to the tunneling electrons. On the other hand, if you use bias voltages above 3 volts, then the electrons then tunnel into silica conduction band, and it becomes possible to observe silica process by scanning tunneling microscope. So, how does silica silicon system look like at different bias voltages? Upper image shown here is the topographic image of silica silicon sample, no plate in a moment, at 0.1 bias voltage. At this bias voltage, we expected to see silica silicon interface according to the preceding argument. Quite often, we found the step structure as exemplified in the slide. The step height is only a few angstroms. Below the DIDV image of this interface, taken concurrently with the topographic image, is shown. Now, this image is taken by modulating tunneling bias voltage 20 millivolts peak to peak and locking amplifying the tunnel current modulation. The image that obtained indicates the variation of electronic density of state at the interface. Within the range of 20 millielectron volt and 0.1 electron volt above the Fermi image. If you compare these two images, you may find that the atoms at the step edge possesses extra electronic density of states compared to the atoms. Now we increase the bias voltage to 4 volts, which is well above the lower edge of the silica conduction band, and now we expect to see the silica surface. What we see at this bias voltage is a relatively flat surface, with stiff structure still visible, but less pronounced. Here, we concurrently vary a height image, which can be related to the work function variation of the surface by modulating the peak sample distance by a fraction of an angstrom and locally amplifying the time current modulation. You may see from this image that this surface has almost no barrier height variation. Now, we vacuum deposit Clayton particles on this silica surface. The platinum silicon silica surface dust breaker looks like this. The deposited platinum forms about 40 angstrom particles showing various spherical appearances. The barrier height image taken concurrently shows a firm barrier height variation of this platinum silica surface, and it appears that the barrier height is higher on platinum particles compared to the silica substrate surface. In conclusion, platinum silica molecular surface was successfully observed by SPM for the first time. This was accomplished by making one silica into a very thin film and then optimizing the handling conditions. And in addition, the atomic structure of silica silicon interface was revealed. I thank you for your attention.
Deals with when you showed that picture with the platinum silica, in addition to showing the platinum surfaces which are raised about 30-40 angstrom, it appeared that in the silica part of the surface some other features were visible. Is that real, first of all? And the second question deals with do you think it would be feasible to or possible to obtain atomic resolution of the platinum particles?
For the first question, there are a number of images I took on that particular sample, and the platinum looks almost alike. Always you can see the data platinum particles. On the other features, I think it's part of a platinum, a smaller particles or something. But silica surface is very hard, and vacuum deposition, I do not think it will alter the topography of the silica surface. So I think that it's a platinum. What I'm looking at is a platinum, the smaller piece of that. For the second question, now, as I quoted in my preprint, this is a handmade SPM, and unfortunately my SPM has not achieved atomic resolution for metals. Carbon is very easy, however, for metals, it's, in my case, it is not. Now, apart from that, I rather doubt if one can really see the plate and metals on, say, silica surface, on carbon or something like a conductive support, then it's very much likely. However, for silica surface, I wrote in a group a little bit that it has a certain problem with obtaining a regular spectroscopy data, and I suppose that it's probably due to the small charge buildup on the surface of silica, and I think it somehow wash out the smaller structure that should be visible, like the step structure. And I think the same thing would occur if you want to look at the platinum platinum atoms on a silica surface. However, it's open to challenge.
Formed by metallic clusters in sodium wide. The authors are Yang and Wu, and it's a submission from the Department of Chemical Engineering, Korea, and Advanced Institute of Science and Technology in Seoul, Korea.
Thank you very much. I'm going to talk about the characterization and catalytic properties of plasmolytic small ionically clusters in NAY. Generalized whole bimetallic clusters, it is interesting to know whether the bimetallic clusters are really formed inside the supercase. Also, the mechanism for formation of bimetallic clusters, the size of the clusters, and the surface compositions. Platinum union bimetallic clusters are prepared in two ways. The first one is co-ion exchange method, and the second one is the sequential clustering method. In the sequential clustering method, the first the platinum clusters were prepared, and then ion exchange with the union cation to make the platinum union bimetallic cluster. This slide shows the observed isotopes for xenon on NAY, the platinum one, and the isotopes for the PT4NAY other bimetallic clusters. The difference between these two isotopes is the amount of xenon observed on the metal component only. The hydrogen consumption of the various clusters indicates that the dispersion of these clusters are all above 0.95, and the amount of xenon observed, and from the theoretical model, we can calculate the number of metal atoms per cluster of these various clusters. The number of metals are all ranging from 36 to 40. I'm not going to detail how to calculate the number of metal atoms per cluster shown in this two slide. This slide is the low temperature 129 xenon NMR spectra obtained from the 1-to-1 uniform physical mixture of platinum 4 and uranium 4. At the room temperature, the xenon NMR gives one band. However, at the low temperatures, it gives two chemical shifts. This is due to from uranium monometallic cluster. This is from the platinum cluster. So there's no formation of the alpha, as we expected. However, the low temperature xenon NMR spectra of bimetallic PT2 uranium 2 indicates the one chemical shift at the even at low temperature. So there's the direct evidence of the formation of alloys inside the supercase. This slide shows the chemical shift of the various bimetallic clusters as a function of iridium in the bimetallic cluster. The addition of iridium to the platinum monometallic clusters, about 25 mole percent, the chemical shift significantly decreased, and further addition of uranium did not decrease much the chemical shift. This can be explained by the surface enrichment of uranium on the small bimetallic cluster. This slide shows the chemical shift of the bimetallic clusters made by the sequential clustering method. The chemical shift of the bimetallic clusters made by sequential clustering method is less than the dose of bimetallic clusters made by the whole exchange method.